Oh, man. Hello, world. What is up? Welcome to Build. I'm your host, Matt Forte. We are here live at the Build Studio in New York City. Netflix's Locke Key is a mystery about love, loss, and the bonds that define family. It's also about a super creepy well lady who does, like, whatever she wants, wears incredible dresses, goes around killing kids and snatching up keys. This show is nuts. If you haven't watched it yet, you are missing out. Joining me now to talk all about it is said well lady, the super talented, the crazy awesome. Make some noise for Laysla De Oliveira, everybody. Come on, do it up.
I love how you said snatched up keys. I think that's going to be my bio now. I love it.
Throw it in there. You can have that. That is yours. This show is fantastic.
Thank you.
And congratulations. You are wonderful in it. I'm super excited to talk to you about the whole thing. Before we jump into any of that, how are you doing? How's the ride been? It's been a month that's out now.
Oh, it's so crazy. I mean, we shot for 6 months and... a lot of my stuff was green screen, so I wasn't really able to see or know how it was going to turn out until I actually saw it. And I was very impressed. I think the CGI is absolutely amazing, and I was blown away. It was actually one of the first things that I did that I was able to watch as an audience member because I had no idea what it was going to be like. A lot of those scenes, I'm not really looking at anything. I'm looking at a pink dot and imagining that things are there. Yeah. They can explain to you what it might look like, but you don't actually know. So you really have to imagine.
How closely aligned to your imagination was the, like, when you finally saw it, we were like, that's exactly how I pictured it, or, oh my goodness, that is wild. I couldn't have fathomed such a thing.
The scene I'm thinking of right now is towards the end where I go into Aaron Voss's head, and you know where I open up the memories. I remember that day was so interesting because I had no idea what I would be looking at, and for the memories to light up, they actually strapped the cassettes to me, like to a lighting device, so I would pretend open things, but it was actually strapped to me. So that was really interesting. So when I saw it, I was like, oh yeah, I actually look like I'm looking at something. Yeah, I had a lot of things strapped to me. Also the fire key, they had like a little, that was a whole strap situation of a key that would light up.
Illuminate in some way so that way you look.
That was a scary day because
it was an actual fire, wasn't
it? It was.
No.
It was actual fire. It was an Yves Saint Laurent jacket. We only had one. And I showed up to set and there were a bunch of firefighters there because of course you have to be safe. And I just remember them saying, if you catch on fire, don't run. It's like, okay, because usually when people catch on fire, they tend to run. I mean, of course, they're just being safe and anything can happen, but being Dodge, I had to do a lot of these things with confidence, and I am a scaredy cat in real life. So they attach this key that lights up to me, and so when you're lighting the stove, when I was lighting the stove on fire, then somebody in the back actually did the whole explosion of the stove. So I was just like confidently walking by. But anytime they would yell cut, I was like, oh, I survived that one. Like it was actually pretty scary. I mean, I think some people would think it was fun. It was fun, but it was scary. For
the big, the big explosion of the stove, that's a high flame. And I just
think
of like,
it was a very high flame.
Anytime I've done like, this is the closest, like the approximation I can get to like knowing this experience. Whenever I do like a tram tour at like a theme park and there's like a scene where something explodes, you'd get a rush of heat that you wouldn't expect.
Yeah.
What was, anytime they ignited that and you were that close, would you immediately just feel like?
You feel it. And also not only that, when you light something, you have to get it in the right angle or else the flame goes upwards and it can actually like go into your arm. So there was a lot of practicing doing that. And then on top of that, you have to be, I mean, Dodge is so confident. So it was a really great exercise for me because I am the clumsiest person you will ever meet. So it was really funny having to do things smoothly. Also putting the key into the keyhole. Right. I'm pretty tall, and they were all the way down there, and Dodge just, like, whips out the keys and does, I mean, so many takes to make it look cool.
You would
I would miss it so many times. I would miss it. I would, like, walk and like trip a little bit. And I was just like, I need another take. I need to look cool doing this. And I'm glad they made me look cool. So I'm very happy about that.
Would you practice that at night? Like, all right, I know tomorrow I've got to open this door.
Well, every door, the issue was also the keys didn't necessarily fit in the keyhole because it is, you know, they're different kinds of keys. So it's not really something you could practice because every set was different and every door was different. You just got better at accepting that it was going to take a couple of takes. I wish they did almost like a key reel of like the miss. Oh, it would be hilarious. Not only me, everybody. It was a thing. It was totally a thing.
Did anybody, dumb question, anybody ever lose the keys on set? Like, would you go to do a scene?
Jackson. It's
like,
who's got the key?
I mean, Jackson had so much fun with them all the time. Not to throw Jackson under the bus. He's so amazing. But of course, he's a kid. He would have so much fun. And we, especially in the beginning of the season, we were shooting in Toronto in the cold and the snow. And he'd be like, there was a lot of, I don't have the keys. I don't have the keys. And the props person would be like, yes, you do. And you'd look in your pocket. I think, what was it? Drink the Ring of Fire scene. Maybe Jackson lost it. We were like, we can't. There are only two keys. And like looking because they were like this big, right? But there was a lot of, I would just be like, you hold on to this. I don't want to lose this. I think there were two of each. Maybe more. Maybe they only told us there were two so we wouldn't lose them. They do that to actors sometimes.
I got like four keys at home. None of them magical. I lose that shit all the time. Like we can't. And it's always like, who has the key?
Yeah.
Oh, you drove the car last, so you have it. And you go through every coat.
I'm getting a lot of messages like, come find my car keys or something like that, which I don't even know where mine are half the time, too.
People are asking you to come find my keys.
Yeah.
What do they want you to do?
I don't know.
What is the end game?
I don't know. They're inviting me over. We'll have to see what happens.
You have the magical ability to start their Honda Celica? Like, what is the ultimate goal?
Which is hilarious because I'm a terrible driver. So, yeah, I only learned, like, how to drive 2 years ago, I would say. Two or three years ago. Yeah, it's actually a kind of crazy story. I was hit by a car as a pedestrian in Toronto, and then I've been really terrified to drive ever since. And even in LA, you have to drive everywhere. And I don't go on the freeway, and I'm always like, okay, so it's going to take me like 3 hours
back
to get there?
All the way, huh?
Yeah, I'm working on it. I'm an adult. I know I should work on that
I'm just fascinated at your lack of real-life key experience prior to starring.
Yeah. It's all acting.
What was, everything is so seamless and so, like you said, there's so much confidence and it's so perfect naturally. That's what you guys are trying to achieve. What was the most complicated sequence of, like, the door sequences must have been a lot of steps, a lot of stop and go. Once you nail the key, then there's not a subway on the other side of that door. So, like, what was that process like?
That was so you open the door, there would be a green or a blue screen, you'd go through it, and then you would shoot the other side and essentially do the same thing. But I think one of the more challenging things was probably the finale episode where I'm floating and so strapped. We did a lot of wire work, and that was super cool, but also quite challenging. It was 3 days of that, and once you're strapped on, you're up there in the ceiling, and you know you don't really go to the restroom or anything like that. Yeah. You have to be, and I drink water all the time, which means I pee all the time. So that was like a really that was interesting, just timing all that stuff out. So they put your harness under your costume, and then they cut little holes, and then they strap you to the, you know, ceiling or whatever, and then they kept pulling me back. And it was really cool, but it also hurts. Like, it hurts your body. You're kind of floating and a lot of ab work. Again,
this
not
is
my
your,
forte.
This is your first time doing all of this, right?
Yeah, it was
your first time doing that.
Your
first time on the green screen, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, it was really cool. I mean, when you get to play the bad guy or sort of be like the sci-fi element of the show, you get to do all the fun things, which I was really excited when I found out I was going to be Dodge.
What was your way into being the bad guy? Because we talk about this. I've interviewed a lot of villains, well, people that play villains, to be clear. And they always say, like, you know, obviously, that person doesn't know that they're the bad guy, right? Like, they have their own story and their own motivation. What was your way in with Dodge? Like,
you mean artistically? Yeah. I kind of knew. I think with Dodge, I think she knows she's the bad guy. Yeah. And I think she has fun with it. I don't know her backstory yet. I know that she's an echo, and because she's an echo, I think it's a little easier to be like, no, this person just has fun being bad. And also, because he used the identity key to be in this form, has a lot of fun exploring this form. Yeah. So what does that mean to me or to you? So that's what I try to do. But I will say that it was my first bad guy. When I told my friends I would be playing a bad guy, they're like, you're playing a bad guy. So I'm really glad that worked out. You thought I was bad, right?
Yeah, I got that vibe completely.
Good, I'm glad.
What was their reaction when they saw how great of a bad guy you were?
All my friends are so happy for me. And for me, it's funny meeting people who don't know me, because now people are seeing me differently. And a lot of times when I meet people, they're like, oh, you're actually nice. I'm like...
There's that weird thing where if people know you for like a particular role, they assume that's who you are.
Yeah, and even on set, it was interesting the first couple of weeks, because people don't know what your vibe's gonna be, and I'm used to everyone embracing, nice, we got a job, yay. And I feel like maybe the first week they were a little bit tiptoeing around me, and then I got a couple like, oh, I heard you were nice, and I'm like, and which is funny because I really try. I think sometimes I can feel uncomfortable in social settings, so I overcompensate by trying to make other people feel comfortable in social settings, which translates to, oh, she's so nice. Oh, she's so approachable. It's really for me. No. No, it's just, it's a weird, awkward thing, you know? Like, I always call myself the most introverted extrovert you'll ever meet. I do get pretty shy, and I... just my defense mechanism is over talking, I think, sometimes. So it was interesting having people tiptoe around me and not necessarily.
Were the kids like that? Were they like a little scared, like afraid of you at first?
Jackson, the first day he met me was hilarious.
What happened?
Kid who plays Bodie. We were doing a screen test for our outfits and stuff, and he was just finishing his, and I was walking in, and he went, hi. And he wasn't sure what to make of me. And then we became buds. And it was hilarious because he had to be scared of me, right? So his mom had to be like, Jackson, you're scared of Laysla. Like, dude, don't forget. But we were total buds. But he's so talented. I mean, he can just turn it on, no problem. For me, I need to prep. Yeah. So I would, you know, try to prep a scene, and he'd be like, what are you doing? And I'd be like, oh, I'm trying to get in character, especially if I'm about to yell at him or, like, yank him or something. I can't have this, like, really fun conversation with him. And I'd be like, I'm prepping. And he'd be like, ugh, getting in the zone. He doesn't need to get in the zone. He's in the zone.
He lives in the zone. At that age,
he lives
his whole
in
world
the zone.
Is the zone.
That's a great thing about being a kid. And acting is essentially you're becoming a kid again and taking away all those barriers and just playing. And I think it's obviously a lot harder for adults to do. And kids, they're living it, which is so amazing. I love working with kids because of that.
When you're prepping and you're trying to find the zone and get back to it, like, does music help? What do you do? How do you get back there?
I'm a music person. Yeah? I'm not someone who can just turn it on. I have to start feeling the mood in the beginning of the day. If I have an emotional scene, that's like my sad playlist, going to work, don't tell my parents not to text me, my boyfriend don't text me. Like, I try to get super vulnerable so that I can just go. But that's my vibe. Happy playlist, sad playlist. I listen to a lot of Billie Eilish for Dodge. Yeah, bad guy? I was like, ooh, this my jam. Like, this is what Dodge would listen to, totally. Yeah. So,
how many playlists do you think you have? You have one for like every emotion, happy one, sad one.
I usually just go to songs, but I definitely have a sad playlist. I'm one of those people.
Okay. What do you mean, one of those people?
I don't know.
What do you put on your sad?
Sad. I'm like, sad playlist time. I don't know. Yeah.
You just kind of lean into the sadness.
Well, I will say, because the one of the projects I did before this was called In the Tall Grass. It was like a Stephen King, Joe Hill situation, and I had to cry or be emotional a lot in that. And so I think that's why I have my sad playlist going on. So that's one I have on my phone right now.
You got to do a really cool thing, can be honest here, for both In the Tall Grass and this, which is you got to dub your character.
I know.
In Portuguese, right?
Yeah, Netflix is so great.
That's awesome.
I just asked them if I could do it, and they were like...
That was your idea. You went back and you're like, hey...
Well, yeah, for In the Tall Grass, I was like, would I be able to dub my own voice? Because, I mean, I come from very humble beginnings, or my family does in Brazil, and my grandma can't read, and, you know, a lot of my family members, like, they don't speak English, and the subtitles are just not their thing. And so I was like, I would love for them to just be able to hear my own voice. place. And so not only were they able to do that, they were able to watch it on the same night because it airs globally. And it was the first time they were watching me do my thing, because before that they weren't really able to, like, a lot of the stuff they don't have in Brazil. And so it was really special. I love doing it.
What'd grandma think?
And it helps my Portuguese. I think she likes it. Yeah, my family keeps messaging me. They're like, oh, you're so bad. You're so bad. And my mom is like, maybe one day you won't play the devil. Maybe you'll be like a nice human being. I was like, yeah, no, I am. No, they're loving it. They just love that it's doing so well and that I'm happy. Yeah, it is.
What's it been like? You know, it's been out for a month. I saw some awesome, like, fan art and, like, sketches and stuff like that. Is that your first time sort of seeing that and being, like, a part of, like, this bigger fandom?
It's my first time and starting to get recognized. So, like, that's super new to me. Actually, on the way here, I was on the plane and I was reading Locke and Key, the graphic novel. I was, like, freshening up. I was like, yeah, I should read this again, because I read it in the beginning when we started shooting, and then I haven't looked at it since. So I was like, maybe I should read this again in case somebody asks me something and, you know, I don't confuse the show to this. And a guy leaned over, and he was like, what are you reading? I was like, oh, it's Locke and Key. And he was like, oh, they just made an amazing show on Netflix. It's so good. And then he went, and it was like so, and I was just like, yeah, it's me. You know, I'm the bad guy. He's like, oh my gosh, that's so cool. Everyone's been so lovely and there's so much love. So I just feel very happy about the whole thing.
How far into the flight did that happen?
It was towards the end.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah. Right? He was behind me. No, he was actually super lovely, but it is always a little bit like, like, what do you do?
I'm going to go back over here for 6 hours.
You know what? I'm always so thankful, though, because when people are watching things, that's like, we are nobody without the fans and without people watching. Nobody. So when somebody comes up and they are so happy about the project or the work, like when somebody talks about acting for me, that's the greatest compliment I will ever receive. I'm in this to make people feel and touch their hearts, and they might not like everything that I do, but when they do, it's just such an amazing feeling. So I think the first time I got recognized was in LA, and I hugged the person. I was like, you're the first person to recognize me. That's because it's so new. I mean, I'm sure I don't know. It's a journey, but I'm just happy. I'm happy that everyone's watching it. That's all.
I'm really happy for you.
Thank you.
You are outstanding in this show. It's fantastic. It's really an amazing show, and it's a lot to be proud of, and it's just super cool. So I'm really glad that you were able to hang out with us. We're not done yet. We're going to do some questions from the audience. We got a couple in there. But if you haven't watched it yet, you're insane. It's on Netflix right now. It's so good. Go watch it right now. You can watch all of it. Get to the end. It will blow your mind. I promise you. It's such a wonderful show. Our first question is coming to us from Xavier. You've got a microphone, Xavier. Where are you at?
Thank you. Hi.
There you are, man.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, thank you. I would like to ask you, what are your favorite type of character when you are on set? Like, with what type of character do you identify more when you're on screen? Because we saw you in the Tall Grass, which is not dark, but, you know, the movie has
more
this
emotional
vibe, yeah, you know? Mm-hmm. And then we saw you on Locke Key, which is amazing.
Yeah.
Trust me. I was like, oh my God, she's so good.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's a dark character and sexy, I have to say.
Yeah.
And you did amazing. So this can be your thing, like, in the screen. Like, you like it?
I think everything is so new to me, so I'm just having fun exploring different things. For me, that's the key, is to do different things so people can see you in a different light. Of course, now after doing Dodge and being bad and, you know, getting to be sexy and getting to do those things and be a badass, it's like, oh, I kind of like that. I for sure would do that again. But I also loved Becky in the Tall Grass. Like, I love getting to be emotional too. I think it can be very cathartic. And so I like work. Whatever they hire me for. No, they're both great. I don't have a favorite. Yeah. Thank you.
Good question, man. Thank you for that. Before we go to the next one, I was just thinking, when were you, how early in the process were you made aware of all the twists and turns and things that would happen?
Yeah.
For
Dodge? I hope I don't spoil it for anyone here, but I always knew that Dodge was also Lucas, because that's in the graphic novel. So I never even thought that was a spoiler until people were like, spoiler. And I was like, oh, yeah, that is a spoiler. The whole Gabe thing, I think, was maybe supposed to be a surprise. But Meredith Averill, one of the creators of the show, showrunner, our first day after the table read, we all had a little cocktail party, and she was like, Gabe's Dodge too. And I was like, what? But I did know going into the show that there was going to be another villain. Like, that was always said to me. There was going to be another villain. And, you know, like, this is your year. There's going to be another villain as well. And I was like, okay, cool. And then when I found out it was Gabe, it was pretty awesome. Yeah. Awesome,
that's the way to put it. We got time for a couple more. We got two more in the room. The next one's coming to us from Kathy. You have a microphone, Kathy. Where are you?
Hi.
Hello, Kathy.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too.
I was wondering, do you find it easier or harder to film a film like Acquainted with your best friends in it?
Acquainted?
Mm-hmm.
That's such a great question. Did you watch Acquainted?
Yes.
Oh, that's so lovely.
I'm a Big Brain fan, so I was familiar
with several. Oh, yay. I loved working with my friends. I think sometimes it's weird to be your friend's love interest. That could sometimes get a little awkward. Sometimes it's better not to know the person. But I really loved working with my friend because it's such a safe environment, so you can really play and you don't get embarrassed and you can totally look like a fool and, you know, they won't judge you because they know who you are anyways. So it's great.
Another great question. Thank you. We'll do one more before we get out of here. This next one's from David.
David.
Oh, how you doing today?
Hi, David.
I'm good. I've been watching since Acquainted and The Tall Glass and The Gifted.
Yes.
My question is this. Out of all those, is there a difference in terms of the film process?
Yes, because Locke and Key, I was a series regular on, so that was 6 months of shooting, whereas the others was a film, so that was like a couple weeks to a month or two. So it was a lot more work, and The Gifted, I would come and go. So it's so fun to just be like, hey, goodbye, you know. Lock and Key was my first job where it was a lot of work every single day. We had two units all the time, and because it's Netflix and they release everything at once, they can actually go back and edit things that they want to in the script. So by the end, you're shooting like four episodes at once, you know. Yeah.
Because they release it the way they do, it's almost like a really long movie.
It is, yeah. Which is great, yeah. But you also have to be very aware where you are on the script because you go back and forth a lot. Fun challenge.
I was just talking to Gavin Leatherwood from Sabrina, and he said they do their 2-bit 10 months.
I love
months,
Sabrina.
10 months they were filming.
Really?
Parts 3 and 4 back to back.
Oh, they did it back to back. Wow.
It's like 10. That's intense.
Yeah.
That's a long shoot.
Yeah. But most shows, I think if it's 20, well, not in the case of Netflix, but if it's 22, as it's like that. Yeah, it's a lot of work. I mean, it's so fulfilling. It's really nice to have somewhere to go every single day, but you don't really realize until you're there and it is like 14 hours, yeah. 16. If you're in hair and makeup, that might even equal to 17 hours a day. And you have to stay healthy and positive. Yeah.
Not put the sad playlist on too much.
Yeah, don't put the sad playlist on too much, exactly.
Well, whatever you're listening to, it's working. Keep it up. You are fantastic in this show and in all the stuff that you do, and I'm super excited for you. If you haven't watched it, go watch it right now. If you have watched it, watch it again so we can get another season of this
watch
thing.
Watch it. I
just
would love another
it.
Season.
It's such a great show. You are so wonderful. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you guys for being a great audience. Thanks to those who tuned in live. Yeah. Lock and Key is on Netflix right now. Do me a favor. However much noise you plan on making, it's not enough. Make more. And join me in thanking Laysla De Oliveira for being here. Come on. Do it up.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much for watching.